Welcome to the world's greatest 2 minutes in robotics, the 2021-2022 game, VEX Robotics Competition, Tipping Point. Tipping Point is played on a 12-foot by 12-foot field by two alliances, one red and one blue, made up of two teams each. The object of the game is to get more points than the other alliance by scoring rings, moving mobile goals to alliance zones, and by elevating on platforms at the end of the match. The VRC Tipping Point field consists of 72 rings and 7 mobile goals. Each alliance has 2 alliance mobile goals, with the remaining 3 goals being neutral. Each alliance also has a platform located in their home zone. Rings are 4.125 inches in diameter. Each robot starts the match with up to 3 rings as a preload. Rings scored in the base of a mobile goal are worth 1 point each. Rings that are scored on an alliance mobile goal or on the lower branch of a neutral mobile goal are worth 3 points each. Rings that are scored on the high branch of a neutral mobile goal are worth 10 points each. Rings that are scored on an alliance mobile goal will count for the respective alliance regardless of where it ends the match. However, rings that are scored on neutral mobile goals will only count for an alliance if the mobile goal ends the match in their home zone. Each mobile goal scored in an alliance's home zone is worth 20 points, plus the points for any rings scored on that mobile goal. As the match draws to a close, robots will start heading back towards their alliance platforms. Each robot that ends the match elevated on a balanced alliance platform is worth 30 points for that alliance. And any mobile goals that are elevated on a balanced platform are worth 40 points. Each match begins with a 15-second autonomous period, where robots can score rings or race to the center of the field to snatch an early advantage in possessing mobile goals. The alliance that scores more points in the autonomous period is awarded with a 20-point bonus added to the final score at the end of the match. Each alliance also has the opportunity to earn an additional win point in the autonomous period by scoring at least one ring on each of their alliance's mobile goals and clearing their autonomous win point line. The 1 minute, 45 second driver control period begins once the autonomous bonus winner has been determined. At the end of the driver control period, after all scoring objects and robots have come to rest, the match will be scored to determine the winning alliance. Remember, VRC games are not scored until the driver control period has ended. VRC Tipping Point can also be played in skills challenges, where one team competes against the clock, remote skills and live remote tournaments, where teams compete from their own homes, the collegiate level VEX-U competition, where teams design 2 robots using advanced materials, and the VEX-AI competition, a completely autonomous challenge using industry-level machine learning techniques. Check out the game manual or talk to your REC Foundation Regional Support Manager for all the details. Official rules and game information for VEX Robotics Competition Tipping Point can be found at roboticseducation.org or vexrobotics.com. To register a team, find events near you, or ask a question on the official Q&A, please visit robotevents.com. Best of luck and have a great 2021-2022 season.
So this is Tipping Point. So Tipping Point is a pretty crazy game. It is one of the more complex games in terms of like strategy and in terms of like robot to robot interaction. It was, again, I've mentioned it before, we do a 2-year development cycle on the games. And so when Change Up and Tipping Point were being designed, it was well pre-COVID, right? And so at the time, it was supposed to be, Change Up was supposed to be a pretty dynamic head-to-head strategic game. With a lot of like robot on robot interaction. And then Tipping Point was supposed to be kind of a like, you know, building on that theme. But since we didn't really get an in-person season of Change Up, now we're just going to go, you know, all to the wall with Tipping Point. So it should be pretty fun. Same thing as before, most of the presentation is just screenshots from the game manual. There are 1 or 2 things that are new that I'm going to highlight, and then hopefully we'll have time for questions at the end. Okay, so scoring. So before I even start talking about scoring, in general, the scoring of this game is it looks complicated when you're reading the manual because it's like 5 pages long. But in general, again, kind of like the same theme as I was going with IQ. Put the things on the things, put the things in the things, and then lift up things and put them on the thing at the end. Like, it, try not to get too stuck in the weeds on hypothetical, you know, edge cases of, you know, rings balancing on top and things like that. I highly recommend, if anybody has concerns about, you know, scoring edge cases or whatnot, think about what would happen in an actual match, right? And then if you have a scenario or you encounter a scenario that isn't covered by like the flowchart, then, you know, then you can ask the question. But we got a ton of questions like in the first week of this game being released that all could be answered just by reading the first few scoring sections. So so with that all being said, let's go through it. So you can put rings on posts, on, excuse me, branches, or in goal bases. Pretty self-explanatory. If it looks like it's in, if it's in, if it's breaking the plane, if it's stacked on top of other rings, it all counts. The one little tricky thing about rings is that if you score them on an alliance mobile goal, they always count for that alliance. It's kind of like safe rings, regardless of where the goal ends at the end, ends up at the end of the match. But if they're scored on neutral goals, then the neutral goal obviously has to be in the home zone at the end of the match. So speaking of mobile goals and zones, that's kind of the bulk, like, visual head-to-head portion of this game is moving these goals around the field, right? Trying to get your alliance ones to safety, trying to get the neutral ones, you know, kind of collected and brought over to your side. If at the end of the match, any part of the mobile goal base is in the alliance home zone, then it counts as scored in that zone. This is your first kind of unexpected thing. So we are going to be doing a somewhat prominent, somewhat major change in next week's game update, where there's been a, so originally the definition of the alliance home zone was the field tiles only. Unfortunately, that runs, it causes some strange edge cases, especially around when mobile goals are up near platforms. So the alliance home zone is going to be changed to a three-dimensional volume next week. You heard it here first, folks. I don't have the exact verbiage to show on the screen, but basically that should make the scoring for mobile goals a lot more straightforward. Basically, if it's anywhere past that line, then it counts. The mobile goal base includes this red portion as well as the black portion. So again, if any part of the goal is breaking the plane, doesn't matter if a robot's holding it, doesn't matter if it's on a platform, doesn't matter if it's knocked over, it counts. So that should hopefully quell many of the scoring mobile goal questions that are out there. Platforms. So you can raise goals up onto platforms or raise robots up onto platforms. Platforms, things that are on platforms only get extra points if the platform is balanced. And so the definition of balanced has these definitions about like it being roughly parallel. Both flat surfaces are contacting the base. Can we switch to the video of the field with Lisa and Jim while I talk about the platforms? So the gist of these rules is, if you haven't had a chance to play with the field yet, the design of the platform is pretty, what's the word I'm looking for? Tri-stable, is that the word? Where it's monostable. It wants to be balanced. Like, unless something is actively holding it down, like the goals do at the start of the match, it wants to be balanced. Can somebody just go like rock a platform back and forth a little bit? Yeah, so the hinge is designed such that it's very obvious once it's flat. You'll either see daylight under it or you won't. And so again, everything around here is kind of designed to make it as easy as possible for refs. You won't be having to break out, you know, bubble levels or things like that to check if it's level. It should be, unless something is actively propping it up or holding it down, it'll probably be balanced. All right, that's good for now. Thanks. So yeah, as I mentioned, you can get robots up there, you can get goals up there, rings, which are scored. Yeah, I already said that. Rings on a neutral goal count for that alliance. So really the like high level version of this game, or the top tier version of this game, is teams trying to collect mobile goals and bring them up onto platforms and balance them. It's a very non-trivial task, or at least I think so, but it's a really fun task. Autonomous win point. So the autonomous win point is here to stay. It's been here for the last couple games. In tipping point, the AWP is pretty simple to get. You have to move this goal off of its starting line, its op line, and you have to score a ring in both of your Alliance mobile goals, on or in. And so it's a task that will probably require both robots to do. And it also, you know, so that's pretty straightforward there. The rules around the Auton win point are the same as they have been for the past couple seasons, where both alliances can get it. You can get it even if you don't win the Auton bonus, so on and so forth. All right, let me see, before I go on a field, let me see if there are any scoring questions. Can a blue team pull a red team goal to the blue team side? There are no rules prohibiting that. Can you move an alliance's mobile goal to your zone blocking? Yes, that is the same question as before. Can you park a robot with a goal in it and get both extra points? Yes, and let me make sure that this is shown here. Ooh, maybe it's not. Okay, it's not in my slides, but there's a note under the definition of elevated, which basically says that for the purposes of the definition of elevated, goals that are in possession of robots also count as elevated. All right, those are the main scoring questions. I see the other questions coming in, but I'll save those to the end. I just wanted to hit the scoring ones real quick. Okay, field notes. Same comment as IQ, we've got two Alliance station options. You've got your kind of standard side-by-side VRC setup, and then you've got your socially distant setup. The socially distant setup does, you know, kind of cause some issues with audience sight lines, but the theory there is, you know, if you're in a region where you're having social distance issues, like, or preferences, you know, you're probably not having stands with 10,000 people in them to begin with, so that's kind of where we went ahead and allowed that. Okay, scoring object orientation. So this is one that I don't think a lot of people have really noticed or caught yet. And it's also not super clear in the manual. So we're gonna add some stuff in the next update. The orientation, the rotation of the rings and the mobile goals is actually pretty important. You have to make sure that you, during field setup, you are orienting them such that they are such that the raised portions are parallel to the platforms. It's the best way you can explain it. Just look at this picture and you can see what I mean. And then for the mobile goals, this is the best picture that has it right now. We're gonna add one in the next update that shows it better. But these the mobile goals have decals on them. Actually, if we can pull the video, or we can switch to the field video, and if you could hold a mobile goal up to the camera that shows the vision targets. Yeah, so if you haven't seen one in person yet, the mobile goals have these vision targets on the side of them that are kind of designed for the vision sensor or the AI camera to be able to locate, or, you know, for you to index within your robot. And so as a result, the orientation of those is pretty important. So they're all, if you can see in this image, it's what these little like triangles are on the screen. Or no, you're seeing the field. Thank you, Jim. You can switch back to my screen now, Veronica. So in this image, it's these little triangles that are all in line with the center line. And then the Auton ones are perpendicular to the center line. So again, we'll have more images that show this more clearly, but that's just something to keep an eye out for. Okay, platform stability. There have been like three questions in the Q&A about this. And I know that people wanted to know about this. So there is a scenario where the platforms can appear to be a little bit less stable than you would expect. And basically what happens there, I know there were some YouTube videos posted where people are like, oh, these platforms are super wobbly and whatnot. Basically what happens is the platforms, the way that they attach to the field is it actually compresses the base against the plate, the foam tile. And it actually uses the foam tile as part of the like rigidity of the whole structure. It's the first game, it's the first field element that has done so to this extreme. And what we didn't realize was that we do most of our testing on, you know, tiles that don't get driven on quite as much. If you are using tiles that are, have been worn down over time, such that they are a little bit thinner than normal, or if you're using non-VEX field tiles, which I know some people do, that aren't the same width, you will get a platform that is a little bit more wobbly than it's intended to be. If you're in this case, there's kind of two answers to your question. The first thing is it actually doesn't affect the performance of the platform at all. We've done some testing. We've had robots drive into them, you know, on small tiles and things like that. So it looks weird. I get it. But it does not impact the gameplay balancing action at all. So you don't have to worry about it. If you do want to worry about it and you do not like the fact that it looks weird, you can replace this little standoff, the standoff that connects the base to the plate under the foam tile. You can replace it with a shorter standoff, basically compress the tile further, and it'll fix it. And that doesn't change any gameplay elements or whatever. So this is going to be in the, I can't remember if it was in the update that already came out or if it's going to be in the update that's coming out next week. But hopefully that answers all of your platform stability questions. One other platform related question. I'll use this slide for it because it's the best one that shows it. There's also been some feedback about the platform edges being sharp and potentially a cutting or yeah, like a sharp edge hazard. This, much like the balls in IQ that I mentioned, this is a first run issue. Any platforms after the first manufacturing run are going to have this. You probably can't see it on my slide, but they're going to have a little chamfer cut on the edges to kind of, you know, reduce the sharpness of that edge. If you would like to cut that, you know, just that small amount, you are welcome to do so as well. That doesn't affect in gameplay at all. Okay, code strip. This is another hot topic. So one thing that we added this year, there's the new sensor, the new VEX GPS sensor. It was trialed, tested, whatever the term would be, piloted by AI teams last year. Now this year, all VRC teams will be able to use it. So in order to use the GPS effectively, I think use it at all, you have to have this code strip installed around the field. The rules say we're going to require it for all events starting October 1 on the field that is used for programming skills challenge. There's already been at least one Q&A about it, and there's been at least one question in the chat about it. The only requirement that the GDC is going to require for the code strip is on the programming skills challenge field. Programming skills challenge is really where the focus of the GPS sensor is. It's a pretty advanced sensor. It doesn't really provide you any help during driver controlled portions. So we're not going to require it for driving skills fields, and we're not going to require it for fields that are used for head-to-head matches. Now, we're also not saying that you can't have it. And so you're going to get into this like gray area of, well, teams who use the GPS during the auton period, you know, do they get an advantage with or without the strip? We're basically going to say it's kind of like having raised fields. It's kind of like having driver station locations. It's kind of like having different field control systems. Whatever you do on one head-to-head field needs to be the same on all the head-to-head fields. If you use the same field for head-to-head and for skills, just you can either leave the code strip on all the time, or you can just take it off when you go to head-to-head. We aren't going to mandate either way for this season, at least. The only thing that we are mandating is the programming skills challenge. Hopefully that makes sense. Notable game, a couple questions, but I'll save them for the end because I want to get through all the slides. Notable gameplay and robot rules. Expansion limits. I don't know if anybody was out there, anybody who's watching was around for the In the Zone EP summit where we discovered that having a 36-inch expansion limit like was broken in the rules. And so that was my first introduction to how drastically rules can change after the EP summit. So this year, the 36-inch expansion limit is the exact same as the one that ended up being used in the Zone, where it's not a 36-inch hoop, it's not a 36-inch cylinder, it's not a 36-inch cube. It is a 36-inch point-to-point dimension. So if you have the expanded sizing tool, that's the easiest way to check it. You just run the sizing tool around the robot. If you have a yardstick, you can use that, and so on and so forth. So this is a good example of a robot where if it was a cube, then this 36 inches would be permissible, but it's actually not, because if you try to run your 36 inch tool across in this direction, it'll break it. So this is definitely one, again, it's like a robot design rule. Like if you don't design your robot to break this rule, then they probably won't break it. And if you're head reffing an event, it'll probably be pretty obvious, like, oh, their arm fell open further than it normally does and things like that. Okay, the next major rule is platforms being safe during the end game. So anytime you have a game with robots balancing, you can either go one of two routes. You can go the turning point route, which was the platform is a free for all, or you can go the tipping point route where the platforms are safe. This rule has a lot of caveats and nuances and in the weeds verbiage. The gist is stay away from the platforms during the end game. Like there's a lot of Q&As and discussions on the forums and everything right now about like edge case implications of this rule. What happens if you do this and then this and then this and that touches this thing and whatnot. The gist is if you are over near your opponent's platform at any point during the last 30 seconds, like you are taking a monumental risk. And so one of the biggest parts of this rule that has kind of caused some controversy is this term interference, or interferes with gameplay, or using a scoring object to cause interference or whatnot. We have some changes to this rule coming in next week's game manual update that will hopefully try to make this a little bit more clear. The gist of it is the intent of this rule is for the platform to be protected at the end of the match. Anything you do to mess with that, whether you did it earlier in the match, whether you do it by accident, whether you do it by a mobile goal, knocking over a mobile goal or whatnot, like you are at severe risk of violating this rule. I don't really have a way to go into much more detail than that, other than to say, go check out the Q&As that have already been posted, as well as keep an eye on next week's game manual update, which will have some pretty key changes that will, hopefully make this a little bit more clear. If you have a specific question about this, go ahead and put it in the chat. But I don't want to spend a ton of time spinning around the axle on this point. Right now, at least. If you have questions, I'll answer them. Okay, on the flip side of platforms being safe, is the neutral zone. So for the past couple of years, we've done the Auton line, which was an opportunity for teams to explore autonomous programming without having fear of your opponents coming over and just running into you. The goal of the Auton line was to increase teams, acceptance and trying out programming. We think it's done a really good job of that. So now we are opening it back up just a little bit. So instead of the Auton line being a single line down the field, the easiest way to think about the neutral zone is that the two lines of the Auton line still exist. They're just wider. You can go into it. You can, reach over, but you can't cross all the way into the opponent's home zone. With these three juicy dodgeball game looking neutral goals right in the middle of the field, it is expected and intended that robots will probably be interacting with each other during the Auton period. The last time I think that this was really a thing that teams did was like Starstruck, because even in the zone, like teams weren't really interacting with each other too much during Auton. So what happens when you allow robots to interact with each other during Auton is there's a lot of risk for things getting tangled, for robots getting knocked over and whatnot. So SG5 is a really long rule with a really long red box. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but the gist of it is that you should view the neutral zone as though it is like a normal driver interaction moment. Most head-to-head driver interactions don't result in penalties or DQs or whatnot. It's just rubbins racing, right? And so if you choose as a team to go into the neutral zone and play that aspect of the game, then you are choosing to, take that responsibility for your robot and, potentially put yourself at that risk. Now, obviously, you can't just go in there and start bashing robots back and forth. Like, obviously, there's still safety, there's still G12, but we're hoping to see some cool interactions here. And we're really hoping that it does not turn into a he said, she said, like pointing fingers, rule bonanza in the neutral zone. Hopefully that makes sense to everybody. Match load rings, another really long rule that basically exists to say, we have match load rings, set them gently in the field. Don't touch robots, don't touch your own robots, don't put them in a scored position, don't throw them at your partner or your opponents. Like, that's the gist. Every like 99.9% of matches should not have match load issues because teams should just be setting them on the field. Like, just don't do any of the other stuff that could cause issues. We like having match load game objects. Please don't like make us not like having match load game objects. Okay, man, we're running close on time. Oh, this is my second to last slide. All right, cool. G12 and G13. As I mentioned in the neutral zone and kind of mentioned at the top of this presentation, this is intended to be a pretty heavily interactive game. The last time we had a really defensive game was, Turning Point, I guess. The year before that and in the zone, there was a lot of concern about teams playing too much defense or playing too rough. And then in Turning Point, we said, hey, there's this platform in the center of the field. We want teams to go for it, King of the Hill, free for all. And people seem to be okay with that once we said that is the intent of the game. So I'm telling y'all, this is going to turn into a heavy interaction game, especially now that we've got V5 for everybody, especially now that teams have had a season to, like, you know, sit in their change up, you know, just design rooms and optimize their robots for speed. There's only 3 neutral mobile goals and there's 4 robots on the field. So there, if you choose to interact or if you choose to engage in that part of the game, you should expect encounters and basically engagement from the opponents in that way. One of the implications of doing that is our typical offense defense rules they end up a little bit strange in this game. And I'm not sure how many people have really thought this through or looked at the way a head-to-head game would be played. But if you have a robot who's holding a neutral goal and another robot is trying to take it away from them, they're kind of both playing offensively and kind of both playing defensively. So we added this red box to G13, which provides some overarching guidelines if you do end up in a scenario where you are trying to make a disqualification call about an offensive versus defensive play. Again, it sounds confusing, but it really should only come into play when you have a robot who is ending the match broken in pieces and you're trying to figure out who to assign blame to, right? In most matches, Rubin's racing. Thanks, John. This one, we haven't gotten a ton of questions about this yet, which kind of concerns me because it's gonna probably be a thing. So just be mindful of this as you start looking at this game. And then there's multiple game manual updates. And those are all my slides. So let me go back to the slide that has the field and I'll start answering some questions. We got tons of questions, which is awesome. And I got about 15 minutes. Okay. I already answered those. So teams need to have equal weight to balance the platform. How heavy are the goals and the rings? All of the weights of everything can be found in Appendix A. I don't know off the top of my head. I think they're also listed in the definitions of the game objects. I'm just going to say they're pretty heavy. Like it's a non-trivial task to move around and lift things up and balance that platform. If a goal is lifted off the field by a robot at the end of the match, is it considered elevated, receiving 40 points? That is a very context-sensitive question that is missing some important context. In order to be considered an elevated goal, it needs to be on a balanced platform or being possessed by a robot, which is also elevated on a balanced platform. You'll probably need to either draw that out or take a picture of what specific scenario you're talking about and post in the official Q&A. Are event partners required to buy the AI field perimeter lining for events? Is it something that a school can print on their own to save on money for shipping? I'm going to need help from a VEX person to know if it's something that teams can print on their own. I don't think it's something you can print on your own. Yeah, the VEX engineers do not recommend printing it on your own. It's been tuned pretty specifically for the size and glossiness and so forth to work with the GPS. So although I'm sure you technically could, there's a high likelihood that it wouldn't work correctly if you did so. And Lisa, I'm hoping you're here to chime in on the other half of that question.
Yeah, thanks, Grant. So one thing I did want to share is the REC Foundation is working on providing one GPS strip to each VRC event partner. So if you are hosting an event this year, please contact your event engagement manager. It will be distributed just like you get your one free trophy pack. So we do have that for you to use for your event this year, if you don't already have one.
Thank you. I know she's kind of quiet if you guys didn't hear. Basically, the REC Foundation is working on EP grants or discounts or something of that variety for one code strip per EP. So if you are an EP that's concerned about the cost of the code strip, I believe it's $40, contact your event engagement manager. Does the orientation of the heptagon base matter for MOGOs, or are there two acceptable orientations for each MOGO? Yes, the heptagon orientation does matter. It needs to match the field layout. Plus or minus, I think it's 20 degrees, which basically works out to being one like angle of the heptagon. One side. What's the term for a polygon side? It's been a long time since I took geometry. Are there any updates on VAIC availability? That is, I'm not sure who the best person to answer that question is, but it's not me. We will look into that and get back to you, or maybe do that in one of the later Q&A sessions. Wouldn't changing the tiles change the height of the platform? Good question. No. So let me go back to that slide. So he's referring to the when I was talking about changing the standoff to make sure that the slide, or I'm sorry, that the, excuse me, that the platform is stable. So the only dimension that matters is the height from the floor, from the field tile, the foam tile, to the height of the platform. The height of the platform to the like real world floor is actually irrelevant, right? Because the robots are driving on the foam tiles. So even if you compress the tile, like if you use your shorter standoff because you have compressed field tiles, then you are, you know, making it the same height, like from the tile to the platform. Hopefully that makes sense. Or honestly, this is one of those things where it's like, we're going to tell you that we are telling you that it's okay, or like it's within the margin of error for a field setup. Stuff's bouncing around and waving around all the time. Like it'll be maybe an eighth of an inch off. It'll be fine. Any timeline when AI registration begins? Jim, do we have an answer for that? Should I have skipped that question?
Yeah, so the AI registration is going to come out really soon. We're just waiting on a couple parts to come in. And then as soon as we have those parts, we'll open registration. But we can't open registration until, because when you do AI, you get all the hardware with it. And so we need that kind of stuff set up in the background. So that's what we're waiting on. It should be cool. In the next couple of weeks.
Cool. Perfect. Thank you. Will all fields at Worlds have the code strip on them? That's a good question. I would imagine probably so. That's the type of thing that so far out we haven't really like planned that yet. But that's where the April game manual update will use. The April game manual update will have all the final specifications of what the fields at Worlds will look like. I would imagine they will, but I can't confirm or deny right now. Where was I? We have four head-to-head fields, and one of them becomes driver skills, the other becomes programming skills. Teams will randomly play head-to-head on the one field with the strips. Those teams that have the sensor will be able to use it during head-to-head. And yeah, no. So that was, I hope, maybe I wasn't clear when I was explaining that scenario. Basically, the direction for code strip on head-to-head fields is that it's going to need to be the same regardless of which field they're playing on, right? And so if you do have a multi-field setup type of event, I recommend either putting the code strip on all of them or not putting the code strip on any of them until you have that like 2 hours over lunch that teams do programming skills or what have you. And if you are, you know, in a scenario where that does not apply to your event, you know, again, work with your event engagement manager. But the intent is for teams to have a consistent experience on the head-to-head field. What is the rule on taking an opponent mobile goal while robot is holding it? So that's, again, going to be a very context-sensitive interaction. It'll basically be some combination of G12, G13, S1, SG10, or whichever one talks about causing an opponent violator. Like, it's probably going to happen. There's probably going to be some heavy interactions, right? And in most cases, that won't be a violation. But there are cases where, you could go too far. And so there is going to be some ref judgment call if you drive up and flip your opponent over to take their goal. Like, yeah, that's going to be a G12 violation. But in most cases, it's going to be, that's the intent of the game, right? We have to set up and tear down our field each time we use it, plus carry the sections up 2 flights of stairs. Is the code strip removable? We can't carry a 12-foot section up the stairs. Yes, so the code strip is held on by Velcro strips, so you can take it off and put it back on pretty easily. I guess I left that part out when I'm talking about people changing their fields during an event. It's held on by Velcro, so it's really quick and easy to take it on and put it off. Oh, and that reminds me, there have been a lot of questions about transporting the platform. We're running close on time, but if we can pull up the video, the field video again. We're running short on time, so I don't want to demo it, but you guys can just point to the stuff as I'm explaining it. So there have been a couple questions about how to transport the platform, because it comes in a couple parts and it looks like it's very well put together once it's on the field. So thank you, Sidoti. You already took it off for me. So basically, this little end cap that Sidoti's holding right now, which is the side of the platform base, is held on by 3 screws, I think. And so you take those 3 screws off, and then there's just the 1 standoff that attaches that base to the field. And so take that standoff out, do that. And then on the other side, it's 2 screws that attach it to the wall, I believe. So 6 screws, and you get the whole thing comes off the field as 1 assembly. And then the size of this platform was actually designed to fit in the back seat, so that 2 platforms could fit in the back seat of a passenger car. Those of you who have trailers or trucks, you're golden. But those of you who do use passenger vehicles, they were designed such that you could fit 2 of them fully assembled in your passenger car. So you shouldn't really be having to take them all the way apart in between events or carrying them up and downstairs and whatnot. Thank you so much. Is there a limit about how many of the off-field rings can be added at one time? I would ask that in the official Q&A, because it's not clear in the rules as currently written, and I don't want to give a specific answer. Not a question, but the GPS strips are like $40, so it shouldn't be a huge deal. Thank you, Mark. Did you say that the polygons was something that will be used by a sensor? If so, please go over again. So can we hold a mobile goal up to the camera? How much time do we have? We have 5 minutes. That's the one that I was looking for. So the mobile goals have these vision targets on the side of them that are basically designed so that the V5 vision sensor or the AI camera can actually like detect it. And the intent behind doing that, and I've already seen at least one robot reveal video that's doing this, is for teams to be like indexing them inside their robot, like to have the camera pointing down and locating it so that you can orient the branches and put the rings on, accordingly. That's also why building the mobile goals in this certain orientation is really important. The other thing too, again, in the AI challenge, so they can look around the field and find the goals. So that's what that vision target looks like. Thank you, guys. There's a lot of questions. I don't think we're going to be able to get to all of them, so I'm just picking which ones I think we'll be able to get to in the last few minutes here. So according to the rules, it looks like you could have both robots and all the goals balanced on the platform. Does that sound right? There are no rules prohibiting this, and I cannot wait. I'll buy a cheeseburger for the first alliance that pulls that off in competition play. Did you mention what? Oh, I'll close with that. That'll be my last thing that I say. What are the dates for 2022 VRC Worlds in Dallas? Do you guys know off the top of your head, Lisa? I know they've been set. I don't know off the top of my head. Or do you want to get back to this in a later session?
Third, fourth, and fifth of May, and for VRC middle school, right?
Can you just Slack it to me? It's really hard to hear.
I'll just
I'm sorry. All right, we'll get back to you on that in 30 seconds. While they're doing that, I will look for another question. I think I've answered most of them. If there's one, 3D printing. I almost forgot. Okay. So we'll start my closing with 3D printing, and then we'll end my closing with what the poster on my wall is. So there have been a lot of questions and a lot of pre-submitted questions and a lot of questions submitted in advance and a lot of questions asked during this session about the status of 3D printing eligibility for VRC. This is going to kind of be my overarching answer for 3D printing eligibility for this season, at least. So the idea behind 3D printing, so I'll back up a second because I'm not assuming or can't assume that everybody knows what I'm talking about. One of the goals of the VEX Robotics competition has always been to create not necessarily a kit-based competition, but a competition in which it was a somewhat semi-level playing field, or at least such that the playing field was accessible by all teams. It doesn't become a pay-to-win program per se, right? That was kind of the older mindset and the older reason why we would always answer about 3D printing. Oh, we're not going to do it until every team can afford a 3D printer and yada yada. I'll be the first to admit. So I'm going to stop screen sharing because there's not a lot to screen share. I'll be the first to admit that, in some of the recent years, like when we introduced some more expensive sensors, some 3D printers have gone down in price. Like a lot of that background of the reasoning has kind of gone by the wayside. So we've been getting a lot of feedback this year, especially that 3D printing, like now is the time when your previous answer, didn't really apply or is starting to no longer apply and 3D printing should be available. And so I think that core argument is a little bit, it's based on, again, this, some of this is our fault for shooting ourselves in the foot for explaining it that way. It's not purely a cost thing, right? It's an accessibility and a resources thing. And it's also about like what portions of the engineering design process and the engineering experience are we trying to promote with the VEX Robotics competition, right? And you can make the same argument about like every team has access to a 3D printer right now. Why don't you allow 3D printing? Well, most teams have access to some sort of cutter device for polycarbonate, but we still only permit a fixed amount of polycarbonate on your robot, right? We're not teams who have access to laser cutters or CNC routers and things like that. Do they have an advantage over teams who don't? Maybe a little bit. And so we have a very limited amount of polycarb that we allow. The other thing too is that while the floor of 3D printing may still be maybe getting more and more accessible, the ceiling is still outrageous, right? You still have metal 3D printers. You still have much higher quality resin printers than FDM or PLA or whatever, FDM printers. You will end up creating an extremely imbalanced structure maybe the floor is still, is still pretty level, but like you've blown the ceiling wide open. And we've been trying to avoid making any rules in the VRC portion of the competition that blow the ceiling quite wide open like that. And let me scroll up for my notes and see if I missed anything. One of the arguments that a lot of people make about 3D printing is, hey, my sixth graders have access to 3D printing now, or like my school has more money for 3D printers than they do for VEX parts. It's like, okay, that is, you're coming from it from a bit of a confirmation bias type position, right? that is not going to be the case for 100% of teams. It never will be the case for 100% of teams. And so we want to make sure that the focus is on the kits that and the parts that are available to all teams. So at least for this season. And the other thing too, one of the other things that I've been hearing a lot is like, we need to get this figured out right away so it could be in the next game manual. This is the type of thing that would never be changed mid-season. I will say that wholeheartedly. I'm not going to say we will never allow 3D printing, but I will say this is the type of change that would never happen mid-season, because that would drastically change robot designs and strategic designs and rules and all that fun stuff. So we hear you. I get you. At least for the time being, we're not going to permit 3D printing. We're not going to permit custom sensors. We're not going to permit unlimited polycarb for teams who have CNC routers. You know, there still needs to be some level playing field elements. VEX AI exists for advanced teams who, you know, can afford 3D printers and sensors and whatnot. RADC, which is an RECF program, you know, offers 3D printing. There are other avenues, right? And there are other ways to teach 3D printing other than in VEX, right? I'm not saying I don't love 3D printing. VEX uses 3D printing for all of our prototypes. I have a 3D printer in my house, like, but it doesn't fit with the ecosystem that we are trying to promote, or at least with the mission that we're trying to promote for the VEX product competition at this time. I'm sorry. I know this is frustrating to a lot of people, but I felt that it was better to just be blunt and give you that answer rather than continuing to string it out for at least this season. So that's my essay on VRC or on 3D printing. We will end with some fun ones. Okay, Worlds is for 2022, May 3rd through the 5th for VRC, middle school, and VEXU and VEX AI. And then May 5th through 7th for VRC high school and JROTC. And then Charla sent me the IQ ones. Basically, where did it go? Shoot. You guys asked too many questions. There it is. It's basically May 3rd through the 12th for VEX Worlds. The exact breakdowns and whatnot will be shared, you know, agendas will be shared, but basically it's May 3rd through the 12th. And it'll be split up, you know, by various programs. And then we'll close it with May 3rd through the 12th is the general block. First portion is VRC. Second portion is IQ. VRC is May 3rd through the 7th. IQ is May 8th through the 12th. And we will end with my poster. Clint, I should have known it would be you who got it right. A couple people guessed that the poster is the, like, so it's every frame of a movie compressed into horizontal lines sequentially throughout the movie. Clint was the first one to guess that, and then he was the only one to guess that it was The Matrix, which is my favorite movie of all time. So on that note, thank you guys so much for your time. Thank you for the challenging questions. I really love these sessions. I love being challenged. Don't ever hold back, and we will see you in the next couple sessions. So thank you so much. Talk to you later.